So, here you are, vigilant, narrowly focused. How's I don't give a fuck going?
What's ultimately interesting to me about this sequence is neither of these guys seem to be enjoying themselves, you know, and that always seems to be such an added layer to most fight scenes in movies, is the sheer sadism that is gifted the proceedings by the villain. And I really like the idea of beginning in sort of cowardice. There was nothing about this that was, you know, the samurai meeting the other samurai on the road. This was like, no, I'm going to sneak up behind you and shoot you in the back of the head if I can get away with it. And that's what the plan seems to be until, obviously, things go awry.
David definitely was searching for some kind of an elevated sense of fear that he wanted to get from the audience. And, of course, he photographed it completely in the dark.
Well, David said to me he wanted it dark. He said, I want this to be a fight scene that exists almost exclusively in the dark. I said, great, you know. Then I started to have a little bit of anxiety, actually, about how dark it was and whether or not I had gone too far. And David said, there are things we need the audience to see, and then there are things that they only need to hear, and then there are things that they can infer. We lit the entire scene once. And it was great because we were able to rehearse things and shoot it in sequence that way.
He hears the brute taking a shower. He hears the television coming from the other room. And these things jump around in perspective with the picture cuts that Kirk created. But the sound was to indicate, oh, this guy has no idea that he's going to get ambushed. But then we, as the audience, are completely surprised because it's the other way around, in fact.
And if you're a garden lover, prepare to be very excited, because this is one of the oldest country gardens.
Stick to your plan.
I love the whole setup of this. I love the stretching of it, how slow it is.
Anticipate, don't improvise.
It's a great example of what the movie is. Killer is in control here.
Trust no one.
It's steady, it's exacting. Until it's not.
Fight only the battle you're paid to fight.
Really started with Dave Macomber's stunt viz. Dave Macomber took the designs of that set, constructed it on an empty stage floor out of cardboard boxes, and then they choreographed and rehearsed it over the course of, it must have been several weeks or months, maybe.
The first thing that I did was go into the dark corners of the internet and just start watching actual footage of, you know, that people caught on street corners with their iPhones of people legitimately beating the crap out of each other. The things that would always make me just react were the big slam. I talked to Don about creating these wild floors that we could pull out and throw 8-inch pads in with high density foam that had been scenic to look like the floor. And then put Sala on a dead man line so that his chest would just kiss Justin's when they would hit the ground.
From that moment on, it's a potpourri of noise and props, very specific articulations of glass. Not only are we seeing the practical props, but then all the beautiful, subtle uses of CG that creates this incredibly anxious, intense sequence.
I love the TV. We discussed this initially as a way that Justin would be so backlit that you would never know that it was him. We were having issues with the power center in the TV. When Justin hit it, it would shut the TV off completely. So we had to find TVs where the power source was off center.
The beginning of this whole thing was, how do we have a fight that really looks like hand-to-hand combat?
And then I kind of threw in this thing at the last minute, which was, they got to keep it quiet.
The stunt world, the sounds that we make are a form of communication. Making sure that the other guy knows that your cadence is correct. And if his sound timing is off, even if I'm not looking at him, I know I have to adjust.
There's a lot of grunting and huffing and puffing and ugging and, you know, to me, I want this to be the world's quietest fight. only in so much as that these two guys didn't want to wake up the neighbors who would then call the cops on them.
And I was like, let's take it all out. It's just going to be bones breaking and crushing plaster. And it was really kind of disconcerting the first time you saw it, because you were like, well, they don't feel like they're hurting each other. It's like, well, they are hurting each other. And Ren has yet to decide whether or not the audience will feel that.
David really wanted to hear the difference between the weight of these two men. Sala is 250 pounds. He's just pure muscle, and I want to feel that house on its stilts, creaking and groaning. And then we'd add low frequencies to Sala so that when he moved, it was like, oh my God, this guy's a menace.
The relentlessness and the exhausting nature of the fight, just the brutality of it, is enjoyable, I think, more when you get built-in pauses so that you can hope that it's over and then go, oh shit, it's still happening.
Then when the tables are turned and the killer grabs the poker iron and starts swishing it, then it's a dangerous sound that he finally possesses. What's really interesting about how Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross came up with the music here was that it's part visceral, part panic, in a way almost horror-like, almost painful, which is exactly by design. Beautiful, evolving, hypnotic in a way, rhythm.
When we did the first rehearsals, Michael ran around the corner of the kitchen, and then the gunshot goes off, and Michael said, it just feels kind of stupid that I'm just sitting here. Can I reach into the drawer and look for a weapon? And David said, yeah, that's fine. And, you know, the drawers on David's sets are always dressed. The kitchens are ostensibly functional kitchens. So Michael reaches in, and he pulled out the cheese grater, and he gave that kind of that amazing face. And David said, okay, great, take every prop out of that drawer except the cheese grater, we're going with it.
David was like, what if we made it sound like it's a beautiful knife coming out of the drawer as if it's going to save him like something from Lord of the Rings? Shing! And then he throws it, and it's this, the cheapest cheese grater.
It was a master plan of let's show everybody the house quietly, and then the fight will go around the house again and conclude with where you started, which helped with finding the weapon under the bed.
We didn't want to cross a line. We didn't want to use really long lenses and disorient the audience. We wanted to be the information to be very clear geographically. I thought that each room should have a distinct color tone. And ultimately, it decided that the bathroom should be the brightest. They're sort of orbiting the bathroom, and that's, of course, where the climax of the scene happens. So I like the idea of the bathroom being kind of the beacon.
And it also gives you a moment to see this guy is committed to the destruction of Michael Fassbender at this moment. That door opens, Fassbender's gonna die.
Ultimately, it was the most satisfying to find his hand coming under the bed.
You know, most people...
Not showing the killer until after he'd shot. But you could cut that completely differently. It could be the killer raising the hand up and firing the first shot and then go... There was a lot of different ways to portray that.
Diva is an incredible dog. We were having trouble getting Diva to settle down and sleep on that pad in the beginning. And we ultimately LiDAR scanned Diva with my iPhone. So the wide shot at the beginning of the sequence is CG Diva, courtesy of my iPhone.
One of the things that we had to do as a special effect was go in and take her tail off because she's so happy to see Sala every time.
That was quite a commitment. There was a lot of stuff with that dog shot through a chain link fence. So it was no easy task to remove a wagging tail.
David was obsessed with Nanby. He's going to chase the killer, and I want to hear the character of the dog when he comes up to the brute and sees that the brute is dead. I want to feel the dog being sad. And then turns to the killer. You are the one that did this. in this whole series of snarls, and Fincher couldn't get enough chomp.
Molotov Cocktail was fun. The wick actually here is CG. The electricians built an LED wick that is doing interactive lighting.
He got really, really close to throwing that thing through the broken window that's in the door.
He's an athlete, yeah, for sure. I've done that walk at the end of the day, broke my ribs and separated my shoulder and didn't want to tell anybody on set that it had happened, and then got back to the honey wagon and couldn't take my shirt off because I couldn't lift my arms.
This is what it takes. What you must commit yourself to. If you want to succeed. Simple.